rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon.
Praise the Lord. Am I still with you? All right. does everybody have a set of notes that would like a set of notes? Oh, wow. It's okay, sweetheart. We'll get your notes. Praise the Lord. Here's my brother, Jesus. I love church too, brother. I love church. I love it. I love to worship God. I love to fellowship with the saints. I love to hear his word. I love to be challenged by his word. I love to see what God has in store. You know, we put an agenda together. We put our bullet items on our list. We number them from time to time. We put the order of service and we say, this is what we're going to do. But we're never in bondage to that. We're never limited to what God wants to do. He is alive and present, and we listen for his voice, and we look for his will to be done. If God wants to change completely everything that we have planned for today, that's okay. If the Lord right now moved upon hearts to draw them to salvation, that would be fine with me. I would step aside. If God said, I want you to worship me for this entire hour, that would be wonderful. I would step aside and we would sing his praise. If we feel the leading of the Spirit of God, we walk in obedience to him. Amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. This morning we're going to look at the 11th of our 16 tenets of faith, dealing with the ministry. Now, if you have the pamphlet on our 16 tenets of faith, or if you don't, there are some in the foyer. I have some here, but when you look at it, our doctrine of the ministry has to do primarily with full-time ministry or being called to a particular ministry. So I'm going to address that in the beginning as I start out, and then we're going to branch off to look more at, of the ministry. As it relates to the church. You with me?
Amen.
Okay, first of all, we're going to look at Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12 as our main text. Paul writing to the church at Ephesus, he says, and he, God, gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. These fivefold ministry gifts, I know I've said it before, you may not consider me a gift to the church, but God's intention is that there would be these fivefold ministries as gifts to the church. We will not address the offices of apostles or prophets in any great detail this morning. I will say this, the apostles of old had a special calling. I don't believe that office is still open today. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 1, he gave the credentials or the specifications or requirements for the apostle, and he said, Did we not see Jesus? One of the requirements for an apostle was to see the risen Lord. I don't know that we are all seeing the risen Lord today. And when it comes to prophets, in this context, were those who were receiving inspired revelation, divine revelation from God, in the writing of the scriptures. There is no new revelation. God is not revealing anything new. We have a revelation. It is called the Holy Bible. So there's no new revelation, and so there is not a prophet in this sense. There is a prophetic gift, but not the prophetic office in the sense as it was when Paul wrote this. You with me on that? I won't get into all the details on that. However, the evangelists, pastors, and teachers are ongoing gifts to the church. We are called. We are all called to ministry, as we'll be discussing as we go along. But there is a divine call to these offices of evangelist. You can say missionary as well. That is the modern day apostle, perhaps. The pastor and teacher. Jesus got up and he talked about the importance of a teacher, the Bible study, or a Sunday school teacher this morning. We have an outstanding set of teachers from nursery school on up to adults. And there's an office. There's a calling to be a teacher. There's a calling to be a pastor. Let me just say a couple of things, as I said to Alan this morning. These are some things that, in the context of the ministry, I could say. I wish somebody else would say them, but I'm going to say them, and there it is, okay? We're all called to the ministry. I as a pastor, was excited this morning when I see two young men standing up here and talking about ministry and coming out to church, and we're going to, listen, there ought to be, out of every church, young men and young women being called into the ministry. It is definitely the case that God calls people out of his church into ministry, to be involved in ministry. Can I say even full-time ministry? To sell your home, give up your career, and go off into Bible college or go off into the four corners of the world. There ought to be people being called into the ministry. But I'll tell you this. It is not a career in the sense that one chooses it as an employment path. It ought not be that just, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? Well, I want to be a pastor because there's a lot of money in it. I can make a ton of money. I could have a bunch of people that love me and follow me, and it will be really exciting when, you know, people, they'll call me reverend, and it's, I really want to be a pastor. I just think about all the fun I'm going to have. It's one of those just, you know, I dream about that. It's not that kind of career path that you choose because, unless you're a charlatan who says, I'm going to manipulate the people, I'm going to get a following, I'm going to have power, I'm going to see how much money I could draw from the church to line my own pockets. Oh, there are those. There's tons of those. God help them. On the day of judgment, I don't want to be standing anywhere near them. But it's not a career path other than being a charlatan that you would choose except for the calling. Listen, if you look up the statistics on pastors and the things that pastors face, please understand, like I said, I wish somebody else would say this. I'm not crying the blues today, and I'm not trying to get your sympathy. I'm talking about the ministry. Am I okay with this? Amen. Brother Pappy, am I okay with this? Can I go on? All right. If you don't have to turn there, but if you looked at 2 Corinthians chapter 11, I've turned there. We're going to move on. But this is the Apostle Paul. He's talking about the ministry. And this is always just, I think it's enlightening. Paul is talking about all the things that he has faced in the ministry. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 28, he says, in labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths oft. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. It means he was beaten. Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once was I stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I have been in the deep. He was out in the water. In journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness, in painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness, beside those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. I just find it ironic that Paul lists the responsibility of the church in the same list as being beaten, shipwrecked, and left for dead. You with me? It's not a career path that you choose because you think it will be exciting. There is a call to the ministry. There is a call to the divine office of teacher, of evangelist, of pastor, and you had better be called, but there should be some that are being called and who will answer the call. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17, the Bible says, "Obey them that have the rule over you, and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you." Here's where I wish somebody else would talk right now. Hebrews is saying that God has ordained these offices in the church. He's ordained the office of ministries, of pastors. And we have to just stop and understand, God is a God of order, is he not? God knows what he's doing. God will put a person in these offices as he desires. If those people are not meeting his requirements or living up to his calling, he will move them and put somebody else in. But these are ordained of God. These offices are ordained of God. And the writer of Hebrews is saying, listen, how about we all work together on fulfilling what God has called us to do? How about you do that? How about we try that? Because otherwise, if we resist what God has ordained, it's not going to be profitable for us. You with me on that? We're not going to be successful in what God has called us to do. Let me just say this. I'm fairly happy. But if you've got a pastor that you keep under your thumb and he's constantly under pressure and he's constantly being stressed out by the folks that he is serving, then he's ministering not according to Hebrews 13, 17. He's not enjoying that calling, and it's not profitable for the body. Amen? So the Bible is saying, how about we all work together and we find our place in ministry and we follow the leadership that God has ordained to see what God might have in store. Amen? We will never know what God's plan is until when leadership calls a trumpet and says, attack! It'd be nice if there was more than, two or three with me, right? And so we have to stand together in this. This is God's divine calling. It is the ministry. All right, it got real quiet in here. I'm still okay, Mr. Pappy, Brother Pappy, right? Okay. All right, now look at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 12. They're in the King James Bible, which I love dearly. Chapter 4, verse 12, it says that the ministries, the gifts of the church, are for the perfecting of the saints. There's a comma there for the work of the ministry. That comma is called the deadly comma because it doesn't belong there. In the original Greek, that comma is not there. In some of the modern translations, you won't see it there. It was placed there by the translators of the King James Bible because as they read it and translated it, there was a little bit of interpretation there, and they felt that comma made sense because they saw it as a list of things that the ministry was to do. Perfect the saints, a comma could act as a conjunction. For the perfecting of the saints and for the work of the ministry and for the edifying of the body of Christ. Are you with me?
Amen.
So what that's saying then is that my job as a pastor or as teachers is to perfect the saints and to do the work of the ministry. See why it's a deadly comma? Because if you remove it, then my job is to perfect the saints to do the work of the ministry. My calling is not to do all the ministry. The pastor's calling, the teacher's calling, the evangelist's calling is not to do all the ministry in the church. Well, pastor, that's what we pay you for. You're the minister. No, listen. To perfect the saints. In other words, my calling is to perfect you so together we could do the work of the ministry. You with me on that?
Amen.
In our Constitutional Declaration, you'll see on the last page of your notes, I included the entire constitutional declaration of the Assemblies of God. But right in the middle of that page, it says, we believe that the priority reason for being of the Assemblies of God is to be an agency of God for evangelizing the world, to be a corporate body in which man may worship God, and to be a channel of God's purpose to build a body of saints being perfected in the image of his Son. In other words, the threefold purpose of the church. Imagine this as a three-legged stool: evangelism, worship, and discipleship. If you take any one of those away, then what you have is an unbalanced stool that can't stand. And if you take away evangelism, or if you focus too strongly on any one of these at the expense of the others, you have an unbalanced stool. You have an unbalanced church. Imagine this. If all you have is evangelism, your church is filled with evangelists. All we do is evangelize. Everybody's going out and they're bringing people to Christ. That would be a wonderful problem. But what you would wind up with, if that's all we did, would be an immature and powerless church. People would come to Christ, but they wouldn't know what to do from there. They wouldn't be growing. They wouldn't know what they're supposed to do now with their salvation. And so we need others. If we have only worship, a lot of churches are built these days on worship. They've got the band, the lights, the smoke, they got it all, and their churches are built upon the worship. If you build a ministry on worship, what you're going to have in a large measure is a selfish church, because it's all about how we feel. It's going to be immature because there's no discipleship, and it again will be without power. We're worshiping God, wonderful, but there are elements missing. And if we focus on discipleship alone, so we have the greatest Sunday school program any church has ever seen. We have our doctrine down. We're solid on all that we believe. We have a church filled with pride. We have Pharisaical church, and we have heady people with no power. Are you still with me?
Amen.
We could quote scripture inside and out, but we're not doing anything with it. We're not going out and evangelizing. We're not worshiping God. And Paul said the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. So what we have to have is a church that has all three in proper balance. That's what the threefold purpose of the church is: a place to evangelize, or to be an evangelism outreach, to worship God, and to disciple believers. And so we're going to look at point number one: evangelizing the world. In Matthew's gospel, chapter 28, verses 18 through 20, we have the Great Commission. The Great Commission, Jesus: and Jesus came and spake unto them, to his disciples, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. In Matthew gives this account of the Great Commission. It's found also in Mark chapter 16, 15 through 18. Now, when we look at the different Gospels, understand this is the same Great Commission. Jesus said all of this. Mark records it one way, Matthew records it another, but Jesus said it all. It's not like Mark heard something different than than Matthew heard. You follow me? They're not in competition. Jesus said all of this. Matthew recorded it one way, Mark recorded it another. In Mark's account, Mark said, preach the gospel to every creature, and these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Jesus is saying to his disciples, listen, all power is given unto me, and now I send you. And this is what I want you to do. This is what the calling is. This is what the ministry of the church is. Go out into all the world and make disciples. Go out into all the world and preach the gospel to every single creature. Take my teaching into all nations and make them followers of me. You with me? I'll get to something you can shout about. Listen, all power is given unto me, Jesus said. All power, all authority. Therefore, you go. You see what he's saying? I have all power that the Father has given to me. I'm going to return to him. I'm giving you that power. I'm empowering you with all power that I have received. And I'm telling you, you now go into all the world with that power, with that authority that I have that I now give you. You go in my name. You make disciples. You preach the gospel. And if there's anybody you run into that's sick, you heal them. If something happens that by accident you drink some deadly poison, while you're on my mission, it's not going to hurt you. And while you're out there serving me, if by chance some viper should jump out of a woodpile and fasten itself on your hand, it's not going to kill you. I've sent you to fulfill my will. So I've got a purpose for you. All power is given to me, and now I'm sending you. See, the Lord has called his church. Remember last week we talked about the church, ecclesia, the called out ones. We are called out. God has called his church. You are called of God. He's called you out of the world, and he's commissioned you to go into the world as his disciple, as his messenger, as his witness. We're to evangelize. The word means to share the good news with all the world. Paul addressed Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. He said, I charge thee, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. Paul's telling Timothy, first of all, he charges Timothy. A charge is a command. As God is witness. That's what he's saying. He's saying, Timothy, as God is my witness, I command you, I charge you, Timothy, go and do the work of an evangelist. Be steadfast. God is watching, and we're gonna give an account for that charge. Go and do the work of an evangelist. Listen, why? Why was Paul so specific? Why did he charge Timothy with such a command? He said, because there's a day coming when folks won't endure sound doctrine. Church, I don't know if he was talking about this day or if there's a day worse than this coming. But I know this, people don't endure sound doctrine. See all these people right here? The church invisible, we talked about them last week. I'm so glad the invisible church is here for this illustration. All these folks are in a church somewhere because they're being entertained. Hello? You watching this? They're being entertained. They're eating bagels with cream cheese and Starbucks coffee. Not much is asked of them. Say something wrong? Okay. Nothing is being asked of them. There are numbers in the church, and the church is growing, and everybody's happy. But here's the problem with that. That's not what we're called to do. That's not what we're called to be. Let me get back on my notes here. They're going to find they have itching ears. They won't endure sound doctrine. When the Lord says, come out from your sinful life and walk holy, there's not even an attempt. Now, you know and I know in our attempts to walk holy, we're going to stumble, we're going to fall, and only the grace of God, we sang about it this morning, the grace of God, only the grace of God it will sustain us and is sufficient for us. But there's not even an attempt to hear that. In fact, Don't bend my ear, preacher. Don't you know that's old news? We don't do that anymore. You can't talk about holiness and sin and repentance. Don't you know you turn us off? We're not going to listen to that anymore. We don't carry our Bibles to church anymore. It's okay if you use an electronic Bible. It's still a Bible. But we don't even do that anymore. We don't preach out of the Bible anymore because the Word of God, it's not relevant. And we're all about relevance today. Come on, this is, church, let me tell you. There's a day in which we live where people will not endure sound doctrine. And they run after preachers having itching ears. Tell me something that makes me feel good about myself. I want to be happy when I leave church. Oh, you could be happy. Weep your way through under your conviction to a place where you are in rest, you are restored before God, and you walk out, you'll float out of here. Amen. Help me, Lord. Listen. Itching ears. There are churches built on covetousness, not sound doctrine. Preachers go through this Bible finding every single verse of Scripture that they can make say something about giving me money or about finding ways to make you feel that God just wants you to be rich and blessed and happy all the time. How come the apostles, the closest friends of Jesus, didn't live that way? How come they all died as martyrs? Where does that go? How does that work? But prosperity message, the whole thing built on, look, I bet you know somebody. I know, I've seen people that are driving around in Mercedes-Benz. Looking the part. In debt up to their eyeballs. Their credit shot, terrible credit. They couldn't buy a loaf of bread on credit. But they're looking the part. They're prosperous. God has blessed them. No, it's hogwash. That's not sound doctrine. And then there's a church that's built on surveying the community. I know I'm stepping on toes. I hope not any of yours. You all, you still with me? Listen. Built on, here's what we do. This is a purpose-driven church, in case you missed it. This is what I'm talking about. They send out the letters in the newspaper, or they make they blanket, you know, a mailing, a mass mailing. They buy a mailing list, and they send out a survey and say, what do you want in a church? We're going to start a church in this town. What do you want from church? Last time I checked, I never met a sinner who said, oh, you know what I really want? I want conviction. I want you to tell me that I'm lost, and I want you to tell me that I need to surrender my life and give up everything I have. That's what I want. I want a church that takes 10% of my income. That's what I want. That's what I'm looking for. I never saw that. You survey the world and ask them what they want. They want cushions, and they want comfort, and they want happiness, and they want pleasure, and they want entertainment. So we're going to build a church like that to make everybody happy. And the gospel, the doctrine, the word of God that brings conviction, that challenges us, that calls us unto holiness, that calls us unto servanthood, is not preached. They won't endure that. You hear me? There's a church down in, what is it in Texas? What town is that in Texas? You know what I'm talking about, huh? 30,000 people? Well, there's a few of them down there. 30,000 people, whatever, an old sports arena thing. Yeah, Olstein, let me preach there one day. They'll empty the. We'll empty the place. I'm just saying. Paul urges Timothy. Preach the gospel. Preach doctrine. Teach doctrine. Because there's a day coming when they're not going to hear it. They're not going to heed it. They're not going to want it. They're going to run from it. They're going to chase you away. Listen, he says it is of utmost importance. Do the work of an evangelist. do the work of an evangelist. What is an evangelist? One who wins the lost, one who goes out and preaches to the lost to come and repent into repentance. Do the work of an evangelist. Because if not, friends, what we wind up with is Disney World. But to do so effectively, we must have the power of God that He's promised. Are you still there with me? We must have the power God has promised us. Jesus said, the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, all power is given me, therefore you go. Luke 24, 49. I'll try and speed up a little bit. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in Jerusalem, in the city of Jerusalem, until you be endued with power from on high. Acts 1, 8. But ye shall receive power. After that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Listen, Jesus said, I've received power, I'm giving it to you, I'm sending it to you, but you wait until you be endued with that power. Jesus made it quite clear that we must first be empowered by the Holy Spirit if we are to be effective in our witness. That doesn't mean that if you're not Spirit-filled, baptized in the Holy Spirit, that you can't be a witness. You have the Word of God. The Spirit of God dwells within you. Be a witness. But to be a more effective witness, the power of the Holy Spirit at work in us will make us more effective. You know, people say, well, look at Billy Graham. He wasn't baptized in the Holy Spirit according to our Pentecostal doctrine. And look at all the thousands that came to Christ through him. I'm not going to argue that. Imagine if he was baptized in the Holy Ghost. Imagine if he was Spirit-filled. I'm just saying. Don't look at experiences and interpret Scripture by an experience or a lack thereof. The Bible says that we will receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon us and we're to be filled with the Spirit of the living God. This is the primary purpose of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Now, there are many aspects of the Spirit's power in us to lead us into all truth, to exhort, comfort, reprove, encourage through the gifts, to help us pray. All of those things are aspects of the fullness of the Spirit of God in us, but all for this ultimate purpose, that we might be effective witnesses for Christ. So how do we witness? I'm sorry, I'm going to try and move it along here. How do we witness? If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you'll find a way. You won't be satisfied. You won't be able to not. While out in the community, act differently. Not as a freak. Oh, that guy's different. One of them Christians, you know, one of them born-agains. Don't be freaky. Don't be peculiar. Be different. Stand out. Listen, you have been called out of the world. Live your Christianity before the world. What does it mean? What does it mean to love your neighbor? What does that look like? How can you be different out there in the community so people will see and know, and you're being instant in season and out of season, Paul says. How can you be ready at all times? How could you be an example? You'll find a way. Live your life before them. Let them see Christianity lived out before you. On the job. I know I've said it many times before, you as a child of God ought to be the best employee that company has. You're there on time. You'll go the extra mile. You don't complain about if somebody's taking advantage of you, you're not a floor mat either. You're not a door mat. But if it's a company trying to earn a decent salary, a decent income to pay your salary, you don't work there for your salary alone. That company does not exist so that you draw a paycheck. You realize that? That company exists to make a profit. And they pay you for services rendered. You ought to be the very best. You should say thank God every day for this job. I may not be like Jesus. I may not be shouting the victory when I'm going to work, but thank God I got a job. And Lord, I'm gonna do my best to earn this company money, because that's what they exist for. And they're paying me to do this. I'm going to be the best employee. If you're gossiping on the job, stop gossiping. If you're complaining about your boss or about your coworkers, knock it off. If you're cheating the company, shame on you, child of God. You, the Bible says, whatever your hands find to do, do it with all your heart. Do it as unto the Lord. You're not serving the man. You're serving Jesus. Amen? So you be the best employee. So the bosses say, you know, by the way, that's probably how you're going to get promoted. I was in management. We didn't promote jerks. You're going to get promoted. You're going to benefit by being the great. But more importantly, you're going to stand out. They're going to say, you know, that's a Christian. Why is that employee such a good employee? Oh, they happen to be a Christian as well. It doesn't take much to put the two together. You know, your coworkers, you're so helpful on the job. Why? Well, you're a Christian. Listen, you might be the only Bible that somebody ever reads. You're a living epistle. People are going to see you and know that's what. Listen, let them say, so that's what Christianity is. As opposed to, so that's what Christianity is. You with me? Be a witness. And when given the opportunity, share your testimony, what the Lord has done in you. Don't try and dazzle them with some miracle story. How many times I heard Christians say, well, you know, I heard about a story of a man who, you know, my pastor told me about this missionary who heard from somebody who was on the mission field, and they said that this happened. You know, a guy got his arm cut off. He grew another arm. You know, wow, praise God. And the person you're telling is standing there saying, I don't believe it. I don't believe it either. But if you stand and say, listen, this is what God did in my life. I was once blind, now I see. I was dead, now I'm alive. You follow me? I was once a rotten sinner, but God saved me. He rescued me. He changed my life. I am what I am now by the grace of God. I'm not perfect, but thank God I'm not what I used to be. Your testimony and your life. Your life, now they're going to see your testimony. They're going to see how you live. And they're going to put the two together. You're a witness for Christ. Be empowered by the Holy Spirit and evangelize. Look it, they're not knocking down our door to get in this place. And so we have to go out into the community as witnesses for Him. And we have to preach the gospel to every creature. And we have to encourage them to come and to be disciple, to grow in the things of God. Amen? I gotta quit. I gotta stop being a preacher. Too long-winded. Never thought that would ever happen to me. Worshiping God. The church exists. The second purpose is to worship God. You won't find revival aside from worship. In His presence, we are restored. Many times in the Psalms we read of hunger to be in His presence. Moses, after God just said, Moses, I will go with you. Moses says, that's wonderful. Thank you, God. But I want to see your glory. Lord, it's great that you're coming with us. I'm grateful that you'll be. But God, I want to see your glory. I want to know your glory. I want to know the power of your presence. Church, do we know anything about that? Is there a longing in our hearts? Do we know what it is to long for the presence of God? Oh, Lord, I'm thankful for this church. I'm thankful for the body. I'm thankful for heat and air conditioning and lights and all this is wonderful. But God, none of it matters if I can't see. I want your glory to fill this church. I'm desperate for a move of God. I want your presence, your power in this church, Lord. I want you to be glorified. I want to know you, Lord, in a deeper and more intimate way. Do we know what it is to desire His presence as the deer craves water? Someone once said, you're as close to God as you want to be. I would like to be. I want to be closer to God. Well, then do it. Nothing stands in your way but you. How close do you want to be? Listen, if we don't exist to glorify God, then our existence is in vain. Worship is not only the song service, by the way. A.W. Tozer said, looking at what John wrote, I wonder how so many present-day Christians, now this is 40s, 50s, and 60s, I wonder how many present-day Christians can consider an hour of worship Sunday morning as adequate adoration of the holy God who created them and then redeemed them back to Himself. I can safely say on the authority of all that is revealed in the Word of God that any man or woman on this earth who is bored and turned off by worship is not ready for heaven. What do you think we're going to do for the rest of eternity? We're going to worship God. I don't like that. I don't like worship. Well, then you ain't ready for heaven, because that's all we're going to do is worship God. We're going to serve Him and worship Him forever. It's not just a song service either. It's a life. See, I can't believe what worship has become. Worship in the church, and I'm sorry, worship in the modern church has become American Bandstand or you know, Casey Kasem. It's become a show. It's become entertainment. It's become the church doesn't enter in oftentimes because they're being entertained. Unless you hand out cigarette lighters, you know, like. It's performance driven. Instead of saying, come worship with me. Come enter in. Come sing to the glory of God. We're here to worship Him. Come. I can't believe what it's come. I can't believe that worship has become only that which is done in the song service on a Sunday morning. And it's not a part of our lives to live before Him in worship. It's something that we are, not something that we do. We've reduced it to a performance, entertainment. Churches market themselves by the quality of their worship. I won't mention names, but I know somebody was discouraged from coming here because, well, they don't have good worship up there. They don't have a live band or anything. You don't want to go there. They don't have what we have. Why would you want to go to that church? Churches market themselves by their, you know, we have great worship. What is great worship? And who are we to determine what good worship is? If God is exalted, if God is being honored, if He is being magnified, if it is the majesty of God that we've come to lift up and exalt, then worship, whether we like it or not, or whether it's professional or not, is pleasing to God because He's all that matters. It's not about us, it's about Him. It's all about Him. It's a sacrifice. It's not about receiving from God, but about giving to God. It's about exalting His majesty. That's what worship is. So the church exists for evangelism. It exists to be a place of corporate worship. Listen, you could worship God by yourself in your living room. You could worship God driving down the road. I hope you do with your CD player. Or if you're really old, your 8-track. That's wonderful. Like me, old. But corporate worship, when the church comes together and we all sing, God, do you sense something different when the whole church is in praise? Have you ever been in a large auditorium where everyone is worshiping God with all their hearts? There is a power and a presence and a sweetness. God is being glorified in that place. Church exists for that. And then building the body. Spiritual preparation. Jesus said, in essence, don't do a thing until you're prepared. All power is given unto me. I send you, but wait until you be endued with power. Don't go anywhere until you're prepared. Wait until you receive the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray for revival. You cannot create revival. I said you can't create revival. That's what happens. That's what's happened in the modern church. The church growth movement has become all about numbers. You know, there was a time when if the Spirit of God was not moving in the church, there would have been prayer meetings called. There would have been all night prayer. There would have been fasting, weeks of fasting and prayer. We need God in our church. Now, nobody wants to do that anymore, and so we have to find some guru who's got a book, a tape, a series, something that's going to bring church growth. So, how do we get people to come to church? And we call that revival. You with me? Our church is growing. They must be in revival. You can't create revival. People are enticed to come by marketing strategies, all the goodies and the entertainment. Charles Greenaway used to say, revival, he said, how presumptuous we can be. You know, he said, you drive by a church and you see the sign that says, revival, Monday through Wednesday. Greenaway would say, dear God, don't show up on Sunday. You'll ruin the whole thing. How presumptuous. We're going to have revival Monday through Wednesday. What happens Thursday? No more revival? See, you can't schedule it. You can't make it. You can't fake it. You can't make it happen. Revival is when the heart of man is revived, it's turned back to God. It means to restore to consciousness or to life. You can't revive the lost. Well, that church is growing. They're in revival. You can't revive the lost. Those without Christ are spiritually dead. They have never been alive spiritually. They cannot be, nor do they need to be revived. They haven't been vived yet. They need to be saved, born again, and made alive. Friends, it's the church that will experience revival. And the church must experience revival. Let me say here the importance of unity. In an ununified body, God cannot, an ununified body cannot be revived. If we're not united, the Spirit of God will not move through. How can He move through a body that is, for lack of better terms, dismembered? There has to be the unity of the body. An ununified body cannot be edified. If I say we must have unity in this church, is there anybody against that? You're right, Pastor, we need unity. We pray for unity. I hear from that, Lord, make bind us together. Everybody agrees, and yet we still have divisions. We still have, you know, hard feelings and hurt feelings and cliques and all of those things. In any church, I'm not in any church. We have to be united. A lack of witness, and I'll be done. A lack of witness is proof of the lack of power. If people were coming, if you say, Pastor, let me call ahead and reserve a row this Sunday because I got my neighborhood coming to church. I've been knocking on doors all week. I've been cutting grass. I've been buying groceries. I've been begging people to come to church. I got a whole neighborhood that's coming to church this Sunday. Pastor, reserve, you know, I've prayed the sinner's prayer. I've led them to Christ. They're all coming to church. Reserve a row. You know, then I know there's power in the church. I know there's power working in the hearts and lives of people. But when the pews are empty and folks aren't coming to church, they're not coming to our church, that tells me there's a lack of power. You getting this? Listen to me. Because Jesus said, it's not what I'm saying, it's what Jesus said. He said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses. I'm sending you, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature, and make disciples. If they're not being made, if they're not being saved, if they're not being restored, then that tells me there's a lack of power in our church. Am I wrong by concluding that? So the lack of witness is proof of the lack of power. When your spirit is revived, you'll find a way to witness. When you understand the call of God, you've answered the Great Commission, you know that you are called and responsible for winning the lost, you'll find a way to tell somebody about Jesus. You might stammer. You might stumble over your words. You might say something stupid in your attempt to tell them about Jesus. God will honor that. People are going to see your heart. They're going to sense the Spirit of God, and they're going to come. Listen to me. You can't mess it up. Right, Chuck? You can't mess it up. When you're filled with the Spirit of God and your heart burns for the lost and you love Jesus with all your heart, you can't mess that up. You're going to find a way to witness, and God is going to honor what you do, and people are going to get saved. Revival is the spirit of a man or a woman being awakened by the Spirit of God. We are to teach all nations. Teach what? Doctrine. This is a function of the church. Sunday school, Sunday morning worship, Sunday evening worship, Bible study, young adults, youth group. We got men's ministry, women's ministry. We've got all type, friends, all of this is a function of the church to teach doctrine. We're teaching doctrine, and we're encouraging one another. And I'm going to the last page. Are you still with me? We're praying for the power of the Holy Spirit to move through us. We're praying for revival. This is a discount generation. A discount age. Let me not just pick on young people. When I say generation, the age in which we live, it's a discount age. Always looking for the bargain. Looking for more power with less effort. Looking for more results with less effort. Pastor, fasting and praying, crying out to God, all that stuff. Can't we just put in a rock band and invite people to come to the concert? Can't we just feed them? How many know if you feed the people, they come? Tell you what, if we had a meal after service every Sunday, I guarantee you we could at least grow in half more of what we have here. You just feed people that come. But we're looking for the easy way instead of praying through for revival. There are no shortcuts, friends. There are no shortcuts. The more we focus on the preparation, the more effective we'll be in ministry. The more we prepare ourselves in the Word of God and seeking Him for His endowment with power, the more effective we'll be in ministry. Until we're on fire in here, we can't expect to be on fire out there. As we close, evangelism follows revival. Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah is in the presence of the Lord. He hears the Trinity speaking amongst themselves. Who shall we send and who will go for us? Isaiah, he's there in the presence of God. He says, I'll go, Lord, but I'm a man of unclean lips. I live amongst the people of unclean lips. And the angel takes a coal from the altar and touches it upon his lips and purifies him. And now he's ready to go and to be an evangelist amongst his people. Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit came upon them, they went out speaking the word of God with boldness wherever they went. Evangelism follows revival. Worship follows revival. John chapter 4, verse 24, Jesus meets the woman at the well. Our fathers worship God over here. You Jews worship Him in Jerusalem. Jesus said, yeah, but the Father seeketh. There's a time coming, and it's now, when the Father seeks those who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. Worship follows revival. When we're filled with the Spirit of God, we will worship Him in spirit and in truth. And revival follows preparation. Isaiah chapter 6, when the coal of the altar is touched to his lips, he's ready to go. Isaiah 40, we sang it this morning. Those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They'll rise up with wings as eagles. They'll walk and not be weary. They'll run and not faint. Preparation, friends. A desire for the presence of God, a seeking to be endued with His power, a desire to know His word in preparation. Lord, stir me, change me, make me what you want me to be. And if each one of us in this church were in that same mind frame, could you imagine what God can do? Could you imagine what worship would be like next Sunday or the following or any Sunday when the whole church says, I'm just so in love with Jesus, I can't wait to come and praise Him. Could you imagine if you've been worshiping God all week long in anticipation for coming together to worship, what this service would be like? Imagine if this whole church walked out of here saying, I'm finding, I love God so much and I'm burdened for the lost. I'm going to find a way this week to tell somebody I'm not going to stop until I lead a soul to Christ. Could you imagine what evangelism would look like in this church if we were filled with that attitude? Could you imagine how the discipleship, could you imagine if everyone said, I'm coming next Sunday morning to Sunday school. I'm coming to Bible study. You're studying the Gospels. I understand you're all learning something. I'm coming to learn something that I might be better prepared to be what God wants me to be. Could you imagine the power, the presence of God in this church if the church knew revival? Revival's not going to come because we invite a guest speaker to come. Revival's not going to come because we change the music or because we show videos. Or revival's going to come when the church responds to the call of God. He's calling. We can pray and say, oh, Lord, send revival. And the Lord is saying, come respond to my calling. Amen. We respond to the call of God. We will be revived. And then God will do as he wants to do in this church. I know I went a long way around the ministry, but I generally do that. Anyway, let's pray. Father, I thank you so much, God, for your church, for the calling of the ecclesia, the called out ones. Thank you for the body, Lord, that you're building.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God. We want to bless you, Jesus. Worship you, Lord God. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me. Our God, and all will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end. Beginning and the end, the Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. Our God, and all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, you are worthy of all praise. My heart with me, huh? And all will